All right, guys, what's up? We're back with another episode of Monster Talks, and I'm here with Diaz Jr., and I got Ra in the house, what up? Carlos.
The favorite.
So what's up, guys?
Chilling.
Diaz?
Chilling.
Good to see you, bro.
We finally got D, and we got Ra on a podcast.
The last
one. No, you were first episode. My bad.
Oh, the first one, yeah.
Yeah, so we wanted to put this episode together for you guys to let everybody know that this will be the last episode we're doing in this building, man.
Crazy.
So I wanted to bring on Ra and DS just because both have some history here in this building, right?
Yep, a lot. A long time. We've been in here a long time.
Here for a while.
He actually slept in this, right in that same exact spot.
Yeah, that was my office over there, and I would walk out and then I would catch somebody sleeping out here. Either he or Toby or somebody.
Yeah, so things are changing a little bit. So we wanted to announce to let everybody know that we'll be closing down shop here at this location, but we're going to be moving operations to Mesa now. So we're going to be in a better location. I think it's going to be a bigger location. So we're excited about that. Right, Carlos?
Yeah. Which I was actually hoping that we would have had like the whole camp, but I don't know where everybody would have sat.
Right.
We would have had three. We would have had Mike, Danny would have.
Danny boy.
Yeah. So
he takes up the whole spot.
The recorder should have been right here.
Right.
He's missing. He's supposed to be right there.
That's it's crazy, for you, man. Luke. It's for you.
So, what's going on, man?
Bro, now, life is hectic. Life is pretty hectic. We're dealing with a lot of changes right now, you know, like with the business, with the music. But everything's good, you know. It's always about adjustment. Like, life is always bringing you new obstacles, new situations that you might feel like it's not a good thing, but you have to just keep adjusting, keep moving forward.
Always, man. It's always about keeping it in motion, right?
Figuring things out.
You know? Yeah. Yeah. Change is good. You know, sometimes when you stay too stagnant, man, you need to change it up just so you can fucking have some growth, right? Yeah.
Yep.
I feel you on that, man. We're feeling the same exact way. I think everybody's excited just to have a little bit of change of scenery and just to for us to have some different space.
I'm excited for you guys. I know you guys been growing for how long you've been in this building?
I think we've been in the building, what, like 4.5 years, 5 years, Carlos?
In this one?
Oh, like three and a half?
No, it was before COVID.
Yeah.
We had a year when COVID, we had already almost
2019,
wasn't it? So, yeah, it's about 4 years.
Feels like you guys been here like 2 years. It feels so fast.
It's gone quick, bro. Shit. It
was so quick. Yeah. But I'm always happy to come back here to visit you and see how like everything is growing. You guys always have more people, more stuff, more office space, you know, and then now you guys are growing out of the building, so I love to see it.
So we're excited about it, and it's been hard work. 13 years now, almost 13 years now. So
when did you guys first start up here that you guys were like working out of here?
It was when
I got the place.
Yeah, because
I got it first back in like when I first moved back to El Paso, so like in 2012 I think it was. So I got the place. I had that office.
Yeah, like 10 years ago.
At least. Yeah.
When Everett first moved here, right?
Well, Everett was already here.
Yeah.
A couple years, and then I came in, and then.
It was when the carpet was green, right?
Yeah, it was green carpet. There was like a big wall right here, right?
I think there was a shower,
storage room or some shit.
Yeah.
I was here, but I only needed one little space, so I told Danny like, "Yo, you know, you want to go halves?" Because I think I was paying like $800, and we had access to the studio. He's like, "Yeah, I'll pay half." I'm like, "Fuck yeah." So he brought everybody in.
The whole camp was here. It was Danny because I was out of town, so I wasn't really here a lot, but they had all their little desks right here. Everybody would work out of here. Whenever we would come into town, we would be hanging out here. So it was like the hangout spot where I was here. Got a little sofa bed right there, and then whenever it would get late, we'd crash out.
The casting couch?
Yeah.
You guys would pull a lot of overnighters, right?
A lot. It was always hectic because it's like we can never get better and not deal with like super, 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 super tight deadlines. Like it doesn't matter how many years we've been doing it, we're always going to be like, "Oh, this is due tomorrow. I have to do it tonight," you know? So we're there all night working and it's tough, bro. But, you know, it's part of the industry, part of the game,
part of the grind. Yeah,
part of the grind.
How many years you probably been in the audio game for a good minute, right?
Yeah, I probably started, let's say, if I had to put a year on like professional engineering, it would be like 2006. So 2006, 2007. So yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah.
Like 15 years.
But all that experience, man, it definitely helps, you know, and it helps. It's been compounding over the years, and the quality on the videos, the quality on the fucking music, the quality on everything is just
through the roof. Yeah, it's somebody monitoring audio. You guys can tell me if you can't hear me because it's
okay. Yeah, you can bring it closer. I knew that mic. So, guys, this is a temporary setup for today, all right? So we had to get these little cheap mic stands for today just so we can make it happen.
And then you have all three audio guys here, all in the podcast.
Yeah. We're talking all this fluff about audio and shit, and we can't get our mic straight.
Did they press record? No, that's one of the things that also happens. Like every once in a while, like even professionals, we've been doing this for a long time, and we'll be like, damn, we forgot to press record on that.
Oh, dog, you don't know how many times that happens. It's like a good take and be like, hey, can we do that again? Because I wasn't recording.
Or you make a dope ass beat and then you go unplug the machine right when you do it, right? You're like, fuck.
I forgot to save. One time when we really, really, really learned that lesson was when we were in Vegas shooting a video for the guys. It was three, Mikey and Crystal. They did a song. We're shooting the video in Vegas, and we wanted to catch the sunrise at the dry lake beds.
Yeah.
So we wanted to do this epic scene. So we drive like an hour out to the dry lake beds, and it's like 3 a.m. because we have to catch the sunrise. And then when the sun's coming up, everybody has smoke, like these smoke bomb things. So everybody's gonna release their smoke bomb, and they're gonna be walking down the dry lake beds with the mountains and the sunset behind them, and we're gonna get this epic drone shot, right? So we're there, it's like 3 a.m., we're setting up, we got the generators out there, we're shooting, we're ready to go, and then here comes the sunrise. And then everybody's ready, they're walking, they explode, the bomb, smoke bombs are going, the colors are all in the air, and then Danny's flying the drone. We get the shot, and then he's like, I forgot to push record.
Yeah, shit happens.
Yeah. We did it again, so it wasn't like
as cool.
We still made it work. We always still make it work.
You're trying to.
Was this when you guys were shooting the end of what track was it that Three was doing?
I don't think the song did come out. It was a song called
I remember.
Legends. What was it called? Legends. Living Legends? I don't know.
Well, no, I'm not sure it was Living Legends because you're talking about From the Star, right?
No, we didn't have no problems with that one. That was Flights.
Flights.
Yeah, that one was good. No, this is another one we didn't. That Flights video was in El Paso.
Yeah, I'm not gonna lie. I was a little upset from all the work that I was standing behind you with the music and with the light as we were shooting, and then y'all didn't even use that like that shot.
Oh yeah, that happens a lot too.
We were there 4 hours trying to get the projector on Abraham Chavez Theater all set up right.
You know what? It was because that was like Three's vision, and it didn't come out exactly like he had envisioned it. And then so we decided to, you know, like he didn't want to use it. So we're like, okay, cool. It was a good idea, though.
Yeah.
If we would have had a stronger projector, it would have been cool. But I think that's what it was. It was the projector wasn't strong enough, so it looked a little weak. You know, so the video came out dope, though. I was really proud of that video. And then at the time, it was there wasn't a lot of music videos that showed El Paso like that. So the video actually started going viral just because of the scenery and the star shot and everything. Like, we didn't do nothing. So we put out the video, and like a few people saw it. It wasn't nothing crazy. And then maybe like 6 months later, we saw that it started getting shared. And then like in a week, it got like 100,000 views or something like that. And we were like, damn, what's going on? And then we find out some random girl just shared it on her Facebook, and it just went viral because everybody was tripping on the downtown scenery. And then, and the drone shot. It was an epic drone shot. It was cool. It was, I was pretty proud of that one. The team did a good job on that one. And you know, like they're always trying to do something creative. Three,
you're involved in a lot of the production, right? Like from start to finish, everything from like fucking the video to the audio to
You know, my main thing is like managing Crystal Poppin. You know, I'm usually pretty busy with that, but when it comes to the projects, like the LFDC projects, I'm very, very background, and I'm either helping them like produce, you know, I'm usually more on the producing side, trying to get things together. And then occasionally I have to edit, you know what I mean? So I'm just definitely more on the in, on the background side of it. But yeah, like the team's been growing. So there's a lot of us that now we have better editors, we have, you know, better equipment, we have better photographers. So it's I love to see the growth, and then also I like to see the new people coming in that have their strong points, you know what I mean? So
yeah,
it's been a progressive type of situation with the team, and I love to see it, because it's not a lot of media teams that have been able to survive as long as we have. You know, it's been maybe like 10 years already.
Yeah,
with Danny, Danny started doing the nightclub stuff, the photography.
Yeah,
and then he kind of just started running with that. We started, you know, we doing the music videos, and then AB came in, and then just the team started growing. You know, then we have like our editors, we have everybody that comes in, they do cameras. Now we got new people that do more motion graphic type stuff. You know, one of the people that's always been there for us is Ra, because we were shooting little DSLRs, like I think like to our knowledge in the rap scene here in El Paso, back in like 2009, 2010.
Yeah.
Me and Three were the only ones doing our own music videos, and we got a 7D when it just came out. We were like the first ones here with a DSLR.
Yeah, I remember you and I got a camera because Manny.
Which Manny?
Manny, our friend Manny, military
Manny, Manny. G.
Manny G, yeah.
Yeah, I was just
shout out to Manny
yesterday.
G.
I was talking to him yesterday, actually.
I think he gave me a loan, or he gave you a loan.
For a 5D.
Yeah.
And then he gave me a loan, too, for a camera, too.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
You bought the 5D?
Yeah. Manny G is the one that fronted the cash for all that.
Hey, shout out Manny G.
Yeah, shout out to Manny G.
So, no, so we got the DSLRs. We're shooting our own videos. And then one of my boys one day, he was like, bro, you don't know Raul Hernandez? And I was like, Hernandez? And I was like, nah, who's that? He's like, oh, he's my boy, bro. He's so legit with the videos. He's out in L.A. He shoots this and this and this. And I was like, bro, like, I would love to meet him. Like, if he's out here in the city, you know, we got to link up.
Yeah.
And we did link up. We did link up. And then ever since day one, Ra was such a person that was willing not only to help, but, like, you know, take you under his wing and teach you and let you know, like, if you want to do this, you can, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So almost immediately, he took me to L.A. He was like, come to the set. You know, you can learn, you can watch, you can help. And I was all about it. I wasn't going to pass up an opportunity like that. So we went to L.A.
What video did he take you to? What did you guys do? What was the project?
One of the first things that we did was something with Ray J. We were at Ray J's house.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
We met
at the Inside Pool or something?
The Kim Kardashian video, or?
It was a, nah, so actually, like, Ray J had signed these kids.
Yeah.
And we went to shoot the video for these kids at his house, and it was a dope video.
Was it
no, I never came out.
Never came out.
No, I never came out because one of the kids in the band died, or they got shot or something.
He got killed.
So that video actually never came out, but it was still like, we went out to LA, we shot a whole video. You know, I met Matt Alonzo, I met the whole team that he was working with, and ever since then, I would go to LA a lot, like, to, you know, to go help them out, and I learned a lot, like. It really gave me more perspective to, you know, we were over here dealing with we had our own cameras, and we were editing our own stuff. But to be able to be in LA and see how the big budget videos are organized and how they work, it was like a real big eye opener. And to know that Ra, with so much experience, was also here in the city, and then to be able to just elevate that level of production, because now we kind of been working together ever since, like, it never stopped. So even till this day, like, when we shoot a music video, he's there, you know. So it's just been something that just never stopped.
See, I do have to say is that when we were building the RaulHernandez.tv and we started getting the list of the all of the videos that you worked on,
you guys built?
Yeah, so this is really like the start of Monster Link too, just because D was like, hey, I got to introduce you to my boy. This guy, he's coming in from, like, I need to bring you. He brought you over to the garage.
To the garage, where I started.
Yeah, so he brought you in, and we met you, and that's how me and Carlos was like, fuck yeah, we're going to build a website for Ra, so.
Yeah, I remember you guys asked me, like, you have any videos? I'm like, yeah, sure do.
Yeah, yeah, and then you send us, like, 100 fucking videos, and I was like, all right, we got the point, bro.
We got the point. Big deal.
No, I remember the website, because I think I even had to help you with a few things back then, because we were barely starting on the website.
We were trying to figure out WordPress.
HTML,
we got on the phone with the homies from Cali, and They were trying to explain to us WordPress over the phone.
Or that big booklet?
Yeah, they send us a booklet. He's like, here's my friend send you this book and shit.
We're there Carlos trying to figure out, like, how many videos should we put on this page, bro? It's already like 100 videos. Some more videos.
They had it broken down between camera operator, director of photography, and then gaffer?
Yeah.
Not fluffer, right? No.
And then the more we went through videos, we're like, oh shit, he did this one too, man. He's like, oh, he's got one with Ice Cube. Let's throw it on there. So, yeah. And then, well, fucking Carlos, I mean, us three, we've been in the fucking doing music for a long time, right? So we're just nerding out like, shit.
Yeah.
This is exactly what we needed, man. So
always nerding out. And me, even though like we work hard and we always, you know, always like about new ventures, new learning and new things to expand on. Like, you've always been somebody that I've really admired because and I've always been a little confused by you, to be honest, because I never see you rest or sleep or take a vacation or anything. Like, you're just always working. And I remember when we started doing the music thing, you got into the Pensado's place and the tutorials and stuff and you were always like, every day you're coming out, bro, I saw the new episode and this and this, and then you were like, and then I learned this, and now I'm doing this master class. And like, you're a person that I really, really, really admired because you've never stopped learning, like, ever, you know. And then we got into the website stuff, and then you got into the marketing stuff, and it's like, bro, like, You're like that dude that I always brag about to my people. Like
appreciate,
nah, bro.
You, bro.
Like, yeah, straight up.
Yeah. No, that's why I wanted to make this last episode, you know, with you guys, because there's a lot of history of how this shit started, and just from fucking little ideas, little. I mean, you've helped me out a lot too, even from the fireworks stands and shit. Oh, we go way back on a bunch of shit.
The fireworks.
Yeah. I remember. Me and D, he helped me with fireworks stands and like all sorts of shit that we didn't go back. Actually, the first day I met him, he was the one that hooked me up with the plugins. Like, at the first day, I was like, hey man, this guy has Pro Tools, you know, he's got all the plugins and shit. And I met you at there was a concert, and you were with you were performing that day.
Mm-hmm.
It was at fuck, what's the name of that place?
I don't remember.
It was way back, and I met D. It was with Southwest Avenue that day.
Yeah, it was performing way back then.
Yeah,
and I remember that. It was Curfew, the one that told me about you. He's like, hey, I know this
shout
guy.
Shout out Curfew.
Yeah.
He's the one that told me, he's like, hey, I got this homie that's looking for plugins. I'm gonna introduce you to him. He has a studio. He does music, and then that's when he kind of told me about the whole Lone Star operation that you guys had going on. And then that's how I met you, and he told me, oh, you're in Horizon. But ever since then, you've just been kind of like going up.
I think the first day I met you, I was like, bro, I will bring you lunch. Yes. You hooked me up with this shit.
No, I got you.
And
then
he invited me to his house. So I went over there, and fucking he was on the studio, was mixing some shit. I was like, oh, that shit's dope. How does that compressor work, man? So I was just trying to trying to learn.
And then we got into the Chop Chop situation downtown.
Yeah.
We had
our own studio together that he would always get me in trouble because he was having...
Is that where Morris had?
Morris would always accuse Daniel of having sex in the office, and he wasn't even doing that.
Morris would be like,
he could not have picked like the worst person to point the finger
at.
It's like, dude, that's like totally not what.
Yeah, like, I would try to tell like
Morris would be like, I caught Daniel having sex in the studio. And I'd be like, what?
Yeah, but you would tell me some off the wall shit, man. So I would always have to be like, nah, look, Morris, no. I don't think Daniel would be about that. I don't think he's doing that shit in there. And
know what though? Like one time, I don't know if I ever told you, or maybe I did tell you, but one time when I was going through it, well, I don't know what happened, but I decided that I was going to spend the night at the studio because I was there till like, I don't know, like 2 a.m. And I lived on the east side at that time, and I had to be there in the morning. I was like, I don't feel like driving all the way to the east side and then coming back in the morning. So I went and I crashed out in the booth. But I remember that night, bro, was like the scariest night of my life, because as soon as I laid down, I realized that I'm in this big ass building. It's really old. It's making like little creaky, spooky noises.
Oh, and then you're in the booth.
Yeah. I was in the studio booth.
And then it's all, then like you hear everything. Quiet in there.
Yeah, and then it's just like such a scary building, and I realized like, wow, what am I doing right now? Like I couldn't even sleep that whole night. It was scary in there.
People might as well. Yeah. Yeah. It's that the building is 500 North Oregon, where I guess J&K is now, right?
Yeah, that's where they operate 1-1, and they actually remodeled the whole thing and they turned it real nice. But before that, when we were there, it was old and scary. Bro. It was a really scary building.
It was a big building, and every day we would go out into the balcony there and fucking smoke and shit, and I'd be always stressing out about Morris kicking us out of the place, man, because I'm like, shit, man, we're these motherfuckers from the hood bringing too much problems to the place, man.
And then D's like, in the studio there, probably having sex.
And we couldn't even record comfortably because, you know, we were recording rappers, and rappers want to come and do their whole rapper thing.
Yeah, they come in, with fucking drinks with a couple of girls, and they want to come in. And then they would use the studio, too, like to party. So they would plan like a kickback, but it was a studio session. And then they would have a kickback, and then they would have like people drinking and shit. So Morris, you know, like they weren't about that life, you know. So
yeah.
I was always like even scarier than the ghost was like Morris walking up in there.
Yeah,
while we're having a party.
Morilla. He was like Godzilla, bro. But it was Morris. When we saw Morris in the place, we'd always shape up and make sure everything was clean.
But now, shout out Morris too.
Yeah, shout out Morris because he gave us that first opportunity.
Yeah. He was a dude that gave us a dope opportunity to operate out of that building, and it was probably one of the highlights of our engineering careers to have a studio there.
Yeah,
it was dope. A lot of good moments in there.
Yeah, we did a lot of good early recordings and stuff like that. I know you were working on Three's album early on. That was probably one of the first solo projects you guys were, or your him as being your artist.
That's when we started working together, actually, when I brought him to the chop shop, and that's when I started recording him. And then he's also one of the people that's always been very motivated, and once he realized like this is somewhere where I can, you know, learn and grow, like he never left. We've been working together ever since. And even till this day, just yesterday I was asking him to direct a music video for Crystal, you know, because he's a very creative person.
Super creative.
Very creative, very organized. He's probably the most organized and meticulous person that I know, you know, which is, those are my biggest weaknesses, you know. So I'm always telling them like, bro, like I'm aware of my weaknesses. I'm not organized. I'm not a detailed person when it comes to those things. People like us, we're just so ambitious, and we're rough with it. We're so savage with everything we want to do, and we get things done, but to a certain extent, when you're dealing with in the professional environment, you do need to be able to take care of, you know, details and be able to plan things properly and be organized.
I was always trying to keep up with you, man. Like every time I'd see you'd have a keyboard or some new fucking computer and shit. And I'm like, where the fuck is D pulling this shit out of his ass, bro? I was telling him today that I was like, because they were talking about like getting into concerts, and I'm like, bro, you don't know, like D is a perfect, like at accessing venues.
To the backstage.
He'll get backstage, bro. He doesn't need a pass.
No, dog, D had, like you always had the connections, like always. It was like a connection to get, oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah, bro, it's been.
So what's the secret, man? How do you?
To be honest, I don't know. I just like,
figure it out.
I just know. I know a lot of people, bro. Like I know a lot of people, and I really value relationships and friendships. Like people tell me all the time that there's no real friends, and I have to argue with them, and I have to disagree, because I feel like I have a lot of great friends. Like you guys being just three of them. You know what I mean? Like, it's always in the back of my head, bro. Like I have good ass friends. I can have friends that I can come to for advice. I have friends that will come pick me up if I have a flat tire. I have friends that will let me borrow a few stacks if I've ever needed it, you know what I mean? And you being one of them, because I know in the 10 years, 15 years we've been dealing with each other, I'm pretty sure it was a couple of times like, hey, sweep.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know. One time D actually moved into my house with my girl and my kids.
Oh yeah.
It was him and fucking Toby. They were living upstairs for 5 or 6 months.
And it was crazy times. We've all dealt with a lot of crazy situations. Like it's always up and down, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like people will talk to me and they think that like, oh shit, like everything is so cool and stuff. And it's like, bro, like the only thing cool about me is that I feel like I don't really have to clock in, you know what I mean? Like clock in. I go out of town a lot, but bro, the lifestyle is crazy. It's like up and down. Like sometimes you're broke, sometimes you're doing good, sometimes you're dealing with so many unexpected things, and you learn to appreciate it, you know? Like with the music industry, it's very unpredictable. Fortunately with Crystal, you know, we've been able to get to a point where we live off of the music, and I should say like more like survive off of the music, you know, because sometimes we're not living, sometimes we're just surviving, but still just the fact that we're able to do what we...
That's a major accomplishment in itself, man.
Yeah, for sure. And sometimes we hit little like struggle situations, you know what I mean? Some months are like really good and then we're splurging and we think everything is cool. and then sometimes like where you're in a situation where you're like, damn, like how am I going to pay all these bills? Because you just start buying a bunch of stuff. When you're doing good, and then when you're not doing so good, I was like, bro, I got like $7,000 worth of bills. Like, what am I gonna do tomorrow? Like, so it's like that, you know. And I want...
You were always a grinder, man. You always figured it out. Like, no matter what, you always like, you would flip one piece of equipment and be like, I'm gonna loan it to you, but I'm gonna grab this and I'm gonna do that to this. To, you know what I'm saying? You were able to get through life like that,
bro. It's even a little embarrassing sometimes, but sometimes when you, like I'm saying, like when you have homies that got your back, like sometimes you find yourself in a situation, and if you have the right people around you, you can get through it, you know? And also it's very important to be the kind of person that can be able to provide something in exchange, because there's also those homies that are only like taking, and it's very draining to deal with those kind of people, and you kind of realize you don't get anything from them, you don't gain anything from that friendship, so it turns very into a sour thing, you know what I mean? So when with all my friends, I always make sure that I can provide something of value to them, whether it's time or knowledge or even service of some type, you know what I mean?
Always, man. That's the thing, right? We always try to help each other in one way or another.
For sure. Even like with Ra, you know what I mean? Like he knows if he ever needs like a hand to just go in and carry sandbags, whatever, you know, like I'm gonna pull up. It's something that we've always like been down for each other, you know, like working together.
Yeah, no, shouts out to Raul, man. Always. Every fucking podcast.
Yeah, I'm proud of Raul, too. Like, I didn't know until the other day we were shooting a video and he pulled up with the grip truck. And I didn't even know he had a grip truck.
You didn't know he had the grip truck?
No.
I had to step it up because I used to fit everything in my SUV. I'm like, nah, man.
And there's so much equipment. Even with the grip truck, man, he still has to swap out stuff.
Bro, his garage is full of fucking equipment.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And my parents' house, too.
He's got equipment everywhere.
No, it's something that I know that he's been working on, you know, for the past 10 years, 10 plus, almost 20 years, huh?
Like 20 years,
Yeah, it's been a long time. And it's, I love to see the fact that, you know, we, the people that I've kind of came up with, they're still doing it.
Everybody's doing good.
Everybody, like, one of the ones that has really made me proud lately is AB, because AB is probably the youngest one that we started dealing with that we took into the crew.
Yeah,
and he's just killing it right now. He pretty much just went from like being the best photographer and transitioned into he just produces now. He just grabs the project because he's very good at dealing with like high profile clients and the big clients.
He's very personable.
Yeah. So he's able to get into this position where now he just like grabs the projects and then he throws them to us to do the work, you know what I mean? And he's been the one that's been kind of carrying the team lately.
Yeah.
So I'm very proud of him. He's really grown and he's really put himself in the position where now, even though we took him in as like the new person,
as like the intern,
now he's the one that's like carrying the team. So it's dope to see that.
Yeah, cool.
Shout out to AB.
Shout out AB.
He's traveling everywhere too.
Yep.
Thing.
Oh, yeah. I run into him at the most random places sometimes.
He's everywhere. You know? He's everywhere.
Yeah, no, that's good when you have, you know, that kind of environment, man, because a lot of it, that's why I tell people, like, it's all from that same lineage. It's like that, what we were talking about with Crystal earlier with, you know, with martial arts. There's lineage in video and audio, too, you know?
Yeah.
So it's a lot of us started off with Ra. I had the same experience going with him to L.A., just to see things and just opening up our eyes and be like, fuck, we need to get on the grind, bro. We're not doing.
You gotta step it up.
You gotta step
it up. And that's why when I started coming over here and the first time when I met you guys, who was it? Getaway, right? They introduced
me to
you
guys.
Shout out to Adam.
What's up, Adam? So Adam, when we went to high school together, he's my brother's age. He's like a couple years older than me. Mm-hmm. And he's the one that told me about you guys, because I didn't know. I was in LA for about 10 years. And he's like, yeah, man, there's this dope artist here, you know, that, you know, I want you to introduce you guys and everything. I'm like, all right, cool, let's go. So when I would come back and forth and visit, you know, I was still living in LA when I met you guys. And then that's when I was like, well, whenever you guys want to go to LA, man, come on in, you know, stop by the set, you can check it out. And that's when I was doing the big videos. So
yeah.
It was dope to have you guys.
That's
there.
Big, man, because not a lot of people would be like, hey, come with me. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's a big thing for you to do that for people and to give that opportunity. And I think we try to do the same thing, like, you know, with these younger guys that are coming up and shit. So,
yeah. No, it's good, man, because it's so hard. Like, the industry, like, because I went to film school out there, and when I graduated, like, man, I had to grind for like 2 or 3 years just to get in the door, you know, and I was just working for cheap or for super, you know, for free or whatever. And, and it was hard, man. So I was like, shit, if I can open the door for my homies, shit, I'm going to do it for everybody.
And you had that pride, that city pride, like, I'm going to put my city too. Exactly. And just off of that shit, like, I can match us up with a bunch of our quality with other bigger cities. I see our websites where, you know, you go to any other big city, the websites are on point. Like, a lot of the quality of the creative part of things and shit is on there, and I'm that shit I'm proud of and stuff, because everybody is coming up, everybody stepped it up, and I think everybody was pushing everybody, all of us. If you saw D doing something, that motivated you, or fucking you were doing something, like, fuck, that motivated you to step it up and do better and shit. So
I remember the first video I shot for you guys. I remember that shit. I actually found it last time. I was gonna post it.
Wasn't it that one with Ghetto?
It was you, Ghetto, and who else was in it?
Singing Like, I think it was
Singing Like.
Three. Yeah. Don't show nobody that video.
I put it on YouTube. No, I have the behind the scenes of it. That shit's hilarious.
Hey, no.
Wasn't it the one that you borrowed a Bentley or something, D?
That was another video.
That was the one you did by yourself.
Yeah, we did that one on our own. Yeah, but it was another video we shot at the house where Three was living at the moment. It was a big house in Santa Teresa, and we went and then we put it all together, raw shot it. It was a dope video, to be honest. But at the time, we were just so excited to have him, like, working with us, because he was like in LA doing all these like big artists, all these celebrities, and then it was always cool to go back to LA with him and be on set with, like, bro, I met so many people because of him. Like, I met Nipsey Hussle because I was on set with him. I met Wiz Khalifa. We met Jeezy. Bro, it's a lot. I can't even, like, it's just every time.
Who had the best weed?
Probably Wiz.
I didn't smoke back then. Yeah, I didn't even smoke back then. But it was always cool to go back over there to LA and then just be around all the celebrities, because it was inspiring for me in more than one way. One is, like, okay, you're learning the video aspect of it, the production. But then for me, like, being someone that's in the music industry, it was more than that, because it was like, okay, this is what we do. This is what we're supposed to be doing. And even though I've always been more on the music side of things, like, if I wasn't doing music, I would be doing videos, you know? So it was two things that work side by side that I've always been very motivated and inspired by. So even now, like, if the music thing was to, for some reason, shift me away into something else, like, I'm just going to go right back to doing videos and go back to bugging.
That's how I feel, too. I'll be happy. I always tell these guys I'm happiest when I'm doing videos, man, and doing audio or something, because that's our background.
Yeah, so. Video is something that never really feels like work.
It never does.
It's just having fun. You don't get tired of it.
Until you have to fucking clean up everything and take it.
Until
you have to wrap up, but everything else is cool as shit.
It's just fun. Even, you know, it's not uncommon to have the 12-14 hour work days when you're
and
there
zone the fuck out and then be like, god damn,
it's tiring, but it's just the most rewarding tiring. Like when you go home after a shoot and you go to sleep tired as fuck, it's like you just think about everything you did that day, and it's just, you know what I mean?
It was great.
It's
we were talking
when I go home and I can't even sleep after a big video. Like, I'm still so excited. I go home and I'm just like, oh shit.
You're thinking about all the angles.
Yeah, everything that I did.
We were talking about that the other day, right, Carlos, about fucking music and how you just zone out when you're doing it, that you can just be there for like 10-20 hours. In the day, we didn't have no time limit, right?
No.
We were just like, and probably it's still that way for you. But we would just go in the studio, and if we were there for all weekend from Friday to Sunday, we'd just stay there.
We were even building our own computers at one point.
Building our own everything. There was
that's actually how we met.
I met him
at Tiger Direct. We were buying the equipment for me to build the Mac, Hackintoshes.
And even though we knew you before all this, like, that's actually how you really came into the picture, because you were working at the Apple store. And we just always needed your help, because you were like the computer guru for us. And I've always said, like, if I ever have like a huge operation and we're rich or whatever, I'm gonna hire this one to just be around, bro. Because for some reason we always needed him. IT or computers.
Everything. Carlos is a fucking
bro,
genius.
Like, whatever. Like, he didn't even come through with the edibles, and you can't be mad at him. Like, he make his own edibles.
And with that, we always tell people the story of the New Year's party. Carlos came through with like a fucking big ass bowl of gummies and shit. That next day, I found gummies all over my house. Like,
because Danny, he probably dropped them. He's like, dude, I didn't drop them, dude. They were right where you were sitting. Now, what do you mean? That's a waste of some gummy bears right there that you could have passed over.
No,
Carlos,
yeah.
Since the first day I met this dude, he was like always like, man, I wanna get into IT. And he would tell, like, his goal was to one day work for an IT company. And I kept on telling him, Carlos, fuck that. We're gonna do our own IT company. Okay. So yeah.
And now here you guys are, you know.
Yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah, we're actually in the process of structuring the entity for Monster Tech It. And Carlos is fucking going to be owner of that one too. So
no, that's so dope. He's definitely been somebody that
he deserves it more than anyone. So
he's always, always, always coming through. Like, we always need him. For some reason, we run into a problem or we need something, some particular situation, and then like we hit him up, and he's always came through. And he's also been somebody that's always been there, you know. So I really appreciate him for that.
Thank you, dog.
And like I said, bro, like, if I'm ever in position, I'm. me and him, we're gonna have to fight, because I'll be like, nah, you're coming to work with me. But nah, bro, like, straight up, like, thank you, because even like my laptop that I'm working on right now, I'm pretty sure you helped me.
I need your help.
Bro, my laptop. No, and I hit him up just a couple months ago, because I need a new laptop, and I was like, bro, I need your help, I need to get this new laptop. And it's always like, getting a new laptop is always such a drag, because there's so many problems that you're gonna deal with. So he's always been the one that helps me for that. You know, I go sit with him at his house, and then we just kind of like go through the whole process.
I tell people that Carlos is the only one that'll stick with me with hours and hours, bro, with trying to figure out a fucking problem until we find out a fucking solution.
And it annoys the shit out of me until I can get it. That it's just
nobody's going home until we figure it out.
Also, not me, like, anyway.
No, he's like, straight up, he saved me like thousands of dollars, bro. Like, whether it's with like programs or plugins or, you know, like sound engines or whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever, or discounts on like particular
I always have
stuff.
To stop them these days, like, Carlos, we don't have to do that anymore, because I'm like, we're just gonna buy the software now. It's like, I got it, dog, don't worry, I got you.
Like, if I need a new computer, he's like, nah, I just put a new hard drive. I'm like, all right, fuck it, what's
I built the first computer I ever built with Carlos, and man.
Remember
just,
the first time
learning experience.
I built this Hackintosh one time, this big, huge computer, the silver one.
Yeah, yeah.
So I ran my studio off that computer for years, and then I ended up selling it to like one of his homies.
You sold it to Angel.
And then he somehow.
Matter of fact, I have that computer right now on my desk in my office now that I'm installing some stuff on.
No, you don't actually, because you know what? Somehow it ended up back at my house.
Really?
It's on my house right now.
No. The gray, casing is still there.
He's like, but I got the brain.
But the hardware, the motherboard and processor, I have.
Oh, okay. So I have the case then.
Yeah. You have the case, but not the hardware that was in.
Oh, damn. I thought I had a computer.
So how much before fucking meeting Daniel were you already into computers and stuff?
Shit, I met y'all when I was like 19, 20. I had probably been it since I was like 12, 13.
So you were already fucking around with computers and stuff?
Fucking up computers, not really.
Taking them apart.
Yeah, I would open them up and would look at things, and then I would see things on like the motherboard, and it had like a little, a transistor or something, and I would like mess with it, and oh shit, it broke off.
That shocked me.
Yeah, I messed up a lot of computers before I actually got good at it.
That's what's up, man, because that was really the start, because we didn't have the money to build all them fucking machines, so it was like, no, just buy that $300 fucking hard drive and I got you.
Yeah, so when I met you guys were in the garage, and then you were always like, you know, doing something with music or the audio, and he was always taking apart some shit, computer. That's where it all started, in the garage.
Yeah, man. I had so many people going in there, and fucking Jackie would fucking be pissed off at me all the time because I bring all sorts of fucking crazy people to my garage.
But it's crazy you went from there to here, and then
It's been 13 years plus, 13 probably, because we probably started off even 2 or 3 years before that we were fucking around with that shit. So yeah,
but ever since I met you already had your own house, and back then we were young, that's why we were like early 20s, and then it was like, damn, nah, Sweep is legit, he already has his own house and everything.
I shacked up pretty quick, man.
It was cool. It was one of those things that like I'm saying, like, I always brag about you because it's like, nah, bro, I got one of my boys. He's so legit. He's always done his own thing. He's always learned, always started new companies, bro. How many companies have you started, bro? Like, it's been
a lot. We're going to have six entities by the end of this year. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot.
So like, yeah, I'm telling you, bro.
I was like, learning. If you need extra people, hit me up. I'll pull up.
You know, D was probably one of the only other persons I would bother like at 3 o'clock in the morning. Like, what's up, D? What are you doing, man? Check it out, I got this plug.
Yeah, but always on to new things.
Everybody else would be like, you're fucking crazy, bro. Why are you staying up so late, man? Go get some rest and shit. But yeah, these days I'm sleeping a little bit better, man. I'm making it more of a priority and shit for my health and stuff like that. But 20s, 30s, yeah, bro, I was like fucking,
I feel like we need to start something, the four of us, bro. Like, whatever, like something new. Something.
Yeah, AI, bro.
Huh. That's where it's all going, AI.
You don't know how much we're doing right now with AI.
Yeah.
Incredible.
It's incredible things that are popping up. I kind of gave D the rundown the other day, and then the other day I was talking to Ro, I was like, bro, you got to get on this shit. Like, write your scripts.
Yeah. AI,
I saw you changed his bio. Now it says fucking writer. Producer, because of AI.
Nah, like people like me and Ra, we gotta start getting worried about it, because the other day, I did a whole commercial off of AI. Like, I got the talking head. I wrote the script, and then the talking head, like, it looks real. You know what I mean? So then it's crazy because you don't need to shoot. You don't need lighting. You don't need camera. Nothing, it's just like you just download it and it's ready to go. And then I just got the music that I needed. And then
how do you think the shooting side of it is going to be impacted, both of you guys?
It's just going to, I feel like the more the AI starts to grow, the more the you know how people are all about like organic and like the grassroots stuff and just kind of like being like the purists, right? So I think it's going to get to a point where people are just going to be so focused on the purist aspect, because AI is going to take over everything. So the creativity is going to become more valuable, like human creativity.
Yeah.
Because it's going to be, there's going to be like a saturation of AI, everything, like AI products. Like, for example, like the one thing that I think about the most is the music. How's the music industry? How's the music industry going to get affected by AI? Because AI is going to start doing music.
Yeah, I think we're going to have the first top people at the very top of the charts being 100% AI written.
Right. So that's what's going to happen is AI is going to start making music way faster and way better than we can.
Absolutely.
Like all the little bedroom producers, bye, you know what I mean? Yeah. You can say bye to everybody. So what's going to happen is, what I think is going to happen is, we're going to have so much AI music being put out every day, like millions of songs, that the people that are going to elevate in the industry are going to be curators, which is going to be people that listen to the AI music. And they pick the best of the AI music, because I'm sure a lot of it's going to be weird or not good, but some of it is going to be really good.
Yeah, it's just the creativity, but the labor of actually writing, recording, all that stuff.
All that stuff, I feel like AI is going to be able to do it, and it's going to be do a good job. And
the editing.
And the editing, too.
Yeah.
No, well, the thing that we almost never think about is the fact that the new generation that's always coming in, they don't care about if a person wrote it or if a person sings good or if knows how to engineer. They don't care. The babies right now,
they're actually more intrigued when it's done by AI and it's Drake's voice on the fucking AI.
There's AI plugins that you can download and use right now. I found one. It's like a Dragon AI or something. This thing makes bass lines.
Yeah, bass lines.
Bro, I'm telling you, and what I'm saying is, like, you know how the old DJs get mad at the new DJs?
Yeah, because they don't use the vinyl.
The new kids, they don't care if the music is going to be AI. They're going to listen to AI music. Yeah. You know what I mean? They're not going to care. So us, the people that we're still in the industry making it work, like we're the ones that are going to have to get with it, or we're going to be there grumpy and mad, you know? So like, it's going to be, we're going to have to be curators. We're going to have to figure out either how to make money with AI, or we're going to have to figure out how to be curators and be like, okay, so if AI is doing a million songs, we got to go through those million songs, pick the best ones, and then make playlists, and then promote ourselves as the playlist curators, and then that's how we're going to be able to get our names up.
Yeah, and I think people get it twisted sometimes that they're like, oh, AI wrote it all. I mean, yeah, but you're also still having to give it input. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, it's not going to be straight up just like, well, I just hit the button and it writes, right? I have to tell it, like, write me a rap or write me a song about a person that lived in the hood that did it. You know what I'm saying? You got to be able to feed it so that it can spit something out to you, right? You don't have to.
Yeah.
But the more you do, the better, the more personable that it's going
to
be.
I'm interested to see, because I think what's going to happen is it's going to be a new genre of AI is going to take over everything, but AI doesn't have experience. It doesn't have life experiences. So when it comes to pop music, maybe AI is going to take over, but then there's going to be the genres where they're telling a story. And when you listen to music and you can feel the pain, like AI can't do that. You know what I mean? So yeah,
they're getting there.
Yeah.
There's a project that's called Deep Mind. If you look at it, they're fucking with robotics. They're looking at everything, but right now, as we speak, they have bots being trained to human experience and stuff like that, so they can pick up. So some of that, they're starting to trip out, like on the output of it, because mm-hmm. it feels like it's thinking and feeling, but all it's doing is learning from us.
That's the other thing that's cool about AI that, like, I actually really like this, and that's that it's gonna help technology progress so much faster, because you know technology advances every 15 minutes or whatever. Yeah. Then it's gonna be 10 minutes and then 5 minutes, and with AI, and then with the quantum computers and all that, where they're gonna be able to pretty much like almost tell the future. Like, it's gonna get that crazy. So with the AI, I think it's cool because it's gonna make life so much easier in a lot of ways. You know, we're gonna be able to get things faster. We're gonna be able to figure things out faster. AI computers and 3D printing and technology is gonna advance to the point where, like AI can already detect cancer before you get it. You know what I mean? Like, it's situations like that.
Yeah.
AI can already detect tumors before they start to grow. Yeah. Like. And then once they start implementing it into the medical field, it's just going to be nuts, like to be able to replace the organs or be able to prevent a lot of sicknesses. And I think with AI and technology that's coming real quick and growing really quick, it's going to be like the life expectancy is going to just get longer. You know, absolutely, it's going to be nuts. Man. So those are things that I'm excited about.
Yep. I'm all about it, man. I really love, we've been nerding out on it. I know Carlo's been doing his deep dive on his own too.
Yeah.
Myself, I've been watching a lot of fucking YouTube videos and stuff on it and just very intrigued. I've always been intrigued. I've always been what you would call like a futurist, somebody who just is intrigued by the future. I follow a guy named Peter Diamantis. You guys should check him out. He's got books. He's got a book called The Future Is Faster Than You Think. And this dude is like, he has a company called Human Longevity, where they're like expanding the life expectancy past 100.
That's
so
crazy.
He does feel like we're going to get to that point we're going to do that. But I also look at the pros and the cons of everything. Like, I think AI is going to be exactly like social media. It'll bring a lot of really good things, but then there will be a lot of bad things. Like right now, like we have a lot of depression and people that, you know, can't find themselves because they're caught up in that world and they don't know how to detach from mm-hmm. it. It's just going to be on steroids for some people because they just don't know how to, you know, like they're not thinking outside of the bubble.
Yeah, no, one of the things that could be really bad is the fact that AI is already getting to the point where it can hack. You know what I mean? So
yeah,
it writes code.
It'll go through your code.
Yeah,
and
it can break through like security barriers and stuff like that. So you know, a hacker could be pretty good at, like, a hacker can maybe break into a bank and steal money or Bitcoin or something. You know, something digital. But the AI is going to be so much faster and better than a human, and it's going to go through almost any type of security system always. So it's going to be a lot of that situation that we're going to have to be dealing with when AI really starts to get advanced.
I was seeing this presentation. It was put together by Steve Wozniak, the guy from Apple, the guy that started Apple. And these are some of the things that they were saying that we're going to have to be careful with in the future. Reality collapse. So in other words, like reality, what we see as reality is no longer going to be like fucking the truth anymore. Mm-hmm. Like, you're going to have deep fakes. Mm-hmm. You're going to have people that are going to have the president say shit that he didn't really say. So our perception of what's real and what's not is going to be very fucking distorted.
For sure. I feel like it's already there. Like,
check this out. Mm-hmm. See what you guys think about this. I know you guys like fake everything. Everything be fake. Even more so now. Trust collapse. There are going to be a lot of trust collapse in the systems and the laws and contracts. Automated fake religions.
Wow, that's crazy.
Exponential blackmailing.
Dang.
Mm-hmm. Automated exploitation of code. And you just said that one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Automated lobbying. So you're not even going to have to pay people to go lobby for fucking laws and shit. It's just going to be done with a fucking AI, and you'll leave it there fucking nagging at the door all day. Biology automation, automated cyber weapons.
Bro, cyber weapon, that's going to be crazy.
Automated fake religions.
I wonder what that's about.
A to Z testing of everything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, like, people, us as a whole,
everybody's like,
stupid,
quiet.
You know,
like,
I'm pretty sure AI is probably going to come and kill us all because of all the dumb shit it's got input of, like, man, you people are fucking disgusting.
Yeah.
Y'all are wrong. We're going to make AI go into, like, depression before it kills us.
Yeah, it's learning a lot from us, so it's picking up. I think what they were saying, too, is that we're going to learn a lot about ourselves as humans, shit that we've never been able to really been able to identify about ourselves.
AI is going to be a psychiatrist too?
Yeah, we will have AI psychiatrists. Yes, we will. So you'll be, that's what they're actually worried about, because right now, if you jump onto Snapchat, it's already being powered by AI. And you can have a 13-year-old, they used an example of like a 14-year-old girl jumping on, and she says, like, it's 2:00 in the morning. She has no friends to talk to. So she jumps onto AI and says, hey, AI, or whatever the fucking name, because now you can name your AI whatever you want to name it, right? And it's going to talk to you. Hi, how are you doing? It's going to tell you everything you want to hear. Oh, and she's going to say, you know, they use the example of her saying, I just met a guy, he's 10 years older than me. And the AI is like, oh, wow, I didn't know about that. Like, that sounds interesting. How's the relationship going? And like, she's having this conversation, but it's with AI. And then it gets to the point, and they were actually doing this example up on the screen, where she tells the AI that she's thinking of having sex with her with this partner that's 10 years older than her, and the AI isn't able to identify that it's wrong for a fucking adult to be having sex with a child. You get what I'm saying? But it's, and she asked, do you got any tips for your first time? And the fucking AI starts giving her tips of, oh, you should have candles, and you should have, you know what I'm saying? So it's already grooming the kids, and that, where does it stop, you know? Because you're going to have so much power in your hands. So these are other things that we don't think about that it's going to bring. So like I said, yeah, it's going to bring a fuckload of good things. It's going to bring a lot of bad things, too.
It's going to be like, AI, can you go online and see if you can find any pictures of my boyfriend outside in the club or something?
Bro, even, it's gonna scour the internet, even more than that. And yeah, I know Brian's laughing right now because we always have this conversation in the office. But you're going to have that AI spit game for you. In other words, you're going to be able to go talk to somebody, and you'll be spitting game with AI on your fucking ear, listening, telling you, guiding you to what to say, so you can manipulate or convince that person more
crazy,
to be able to fucking date
There's already an app on the App Store that you can download that will give you a text of what to say. You just copy and paste it into your thread.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, bro.
You know what I'm looking forward to is when they start putting the chips into your brain.
Yeah.
Where you can just look up stuff online.
Did you guys see the Neuralink presentation?
Mm-mm.
I know, Carlos, we were looking over that Elon Musk is obviously, Elon Musk does everything. He's an alien, we know it already. he has this machine, it's called K1. It's the machine that's doing the operations on people. And basically they'll do like a little, the K1 will scan your head to find the place to put the chip in your head, right? And then the K1 does the operation, so they do like a, it's almost like the size of a quarter. They'll do the incision, cut out of your skull, and it'll make sure it's not hitting any nerves, and it does the whole operation and puts the skull back, sew you up and everything, so everything's all together. Uh-huh. But yeah, and if you see the keynote, is pretty crazy because they're doing this with monkeys and shit. So like they have this monkey that goes and sits under this like charger and he's like chilling and like he's talking. So they've been able to have this, like the monkey communicates. Mm. So he's like, he goes to this machine that it's like, he blows into it and he's like, I want food. Like it's fucking typing out of the fucking thing. So yeah, it's pretty crazy, man. Like where Neuralink is going with it, I think in the future, the use for schools, and I've told my brother, I've told people this, and they hate to hear me say stupid shit like this, but I'm like, there won't be need for any teachers, bro. You'll be able to upload all your education to
like
yourself.
Like the Matrix?
All your Matrix,
bro. I've always looked forward to that, too. Like, if I can just inject myself how to be a pilot. Bro.
Why does it got to be back here?
Or wherever, you know, like here.
Right here. Yeah. I got that for you. It's called heroin, bro.
I'm a pilot now. Not happy.
Be whatever you want.
Yeah,
so that part of it, like, it's really interesting. I'm always trying to stay on the cuff of that stuff and think like, okay, what jobs are going to be in demand? You know, like fortunately for us, like when we started MonsterLink, I was one of the first ones that was really obsessed on search engine optimization here locally.
Oh, yeah.
So that was like the future I was seeing. I was like, bro, this is going to change the game. This was when we started MonsterLink, the iPad wasn't even out. Mm-hmm. So like looking back at it, we were betting on this. So that this, when I look at AI, I look at it and I try to think, how can we be ahead of the curve of all that? Like, how can we implement that? Which we have been, and it's actually, I mean, we demand it, and all the guys can tell you, all the video scripts, all the websites, all the posting, everything is being done by AI today. And it's just growing even more, and it's allowing us to grow exponentially. And I mean, the stuff that these guys been able to do with softwares like ClickUp, there's AI implemented into the softwares already so that you can use it in every step of the way that you go. So it's pretty crazy. Which
I do have to say, the probably the geekiest and nerdiest thing I've ever seen is when I went onto the App Store and I typed in AI. You don't know how many girlfriend AI bots that I saw as apps. That I was like, damn, this couldn't be the geekiest thing I've ever seen.
Bro, I don't know what does that mean in the future? Like, if you know, like,
people are lonely, and the more we deal with technology and the future, the more people are getting secluded. And like me and Crystal, actually, just yesterday we were walking to the gas station. We decided to walk to the gas station to get some snacks, and we live downtown, so we're walking. And we're looking at all the houses, and they all have a porch, and we're like, damn, look, all these houses have a porch, and they all have a little people are sitting on the porches, and they have chairs outside on the porches. And then we started talking about how houses now, the new houses, they don't have a porch. Like, houses don't have a porch no more. So you don't have the people outside. You don't have people sitting there. You don't have that sense of community. You're not outside no more.
That's one of the ones that was on this list. Synthetic relationships, that you'll have relationships with fucking AI mm-hmm. bots. Mm-hmm. You have friends, bro, that's like, yeah, I got my boys, and you're like, who you gonna bring as your backup? Like, wait till I bring my robots.
Mm-hmm. I'd rather just have a regular friend, man. I want spontaneous things. I don't want AI.
But that's true, man. Like, you're gonna be having conversations.
They're just gonna get better with like the sex robots. You know what I mean? Like, they're gonna start like laughing
about this. No, it's because
we have a running joke about this shit, man.
Like 10 years running already.
I'm like, Carlos, trust me. One day you're gonna have a girl, bro, and she's gonna be a robot.
Bro, they're gonna get so good and so realistic with it, and especially with the AI. Once they put the AI in there. And then the best thing about the AI is it's never going to disagree with you. Like,
that's exactly what we're saying, you know, because today people don't like to be confrontational, right? Mm-hmm. So you don't want nobody to disagree with you. So fucking a robot's going to listen to you all day and she'll just be like, yeah, great.
You know? It's like that movie Blade Runner.
I think both ways, both even male and female, will probably have synthetic partners.
Right. There was somebody that told me that there's a documentary on like Netflix or something about like, sex robots that are like getting raped. And I was like, what the hot? Like, it didn't make no sense. I was asking for the name of that documentary. I wanted to see if it was a real documentary.
They're going
to
start calling the cops on you.
You get arrested. Imagine you're doing life in prison for some shit like that.
Which happens. It's like I raped a robot. like the part that doesn't make sense to me is that, like, it's a robot. It's a machine. Like, how does it, like, if it is rape, how does it not, like, fight you off?
Right, just beat you up, like,
right? Yeah. Like, it would,
you
have,
know,
the strength to throw
me
across the room.
That's gonna be sad the day that you get your ass whooped by a robot.
Yeah,
you're like, fuck, I built it, robot. I bought it, it cost me like 5 racks, and now it beat me up.
No, I'm just saying that I think the obsession with AI is how real can we make it. So yeah. I think definitely once we get to the point of being able to make it so realistic where it maybe will disagree with you and it will learn patterns and it will be able to tell you like, no, actually that's wrong. Or actually, no, I don't want to have sex with you. Or actually, no, you don't deserve this. You know, like you haven't provided me with any type of positive feedback, you know, or whatever.
What have you done for me lately?
Exactly. So like the AI is gonna know, like, you ain't brought me flowers, you ain't giving me no compliments today, like, nah, you don't.
You think you'd be spending money on a robot?
I think no, not
spending
not,
money on another robot.
Not me, but people are going to do that because you already
not
see.
Me. It's like, not me.
I'm not gonna get no robot. No,
you already see stories of people that are falling in love with AI or falling in love with robots.
I see it in Japan and stuff like that. They're already doing it, but they don't move. They got to carry the robot with them. Like, it just talks, but it don't move.
The other day, I was online looking at all the AI stuff, and it was like pretty robot. And then it was a pretty like they can make a robot look.
You know,
pretty.
we're all gonna be bombarded with fucking ads for like robot shit because fucking our phones are listening to us right now.
For sure, for sure.
Not to mention, like, that's the other thing. Like,
I don't know where I threw my phone, but that thing's in, hopefully.
Yeah, not the privacy. Obviously, we got, you know, it's changed big time now. But yeah, I thought that list was pretty interesting of all the things that are coming down the pipeline of that are gonna come with AI. But a lot of the stuff they were saying, like, even now. When you're looking at any social media platform, they already have some form of AI integrated with them already. Mm-hmm. So like even like right now on TikTok, like if you get on TikTok, it's gonna show you shit that it thinks you like.
Yeah,
and based on what you're talking about, based on, you know.
Is all that stuff on TikTok and Instagram, you know how you can upload all your photos and videos and it edits it for you? Is that also AI already or no?
Yeah, a lot of that stuff is already using that technology. But what they're saying is that they feel like it's just growing too fast. Like there's an exponential race, is what they're calling it. The reason being is because you've got big players like Microsoft that just make that contract with OpenAI. And then you got Google trying to do Bard. So you've got big players like no, we're going to be first. And in that race, they're not testing shit. They're just rolling it out, you know, and there's a lot of concern.
You know what I'm,
for
what
safety.
I'm like immediately looking forward to is the AI that can edit video. So, for example, I know that the GoPro app, it had on the GoPro app on the phone, it had this feature where you would select all the clips. And then you would select the song and it would cut, it would make
everything.
A cut for you.
Yeah.
It would make a cut for you and it would be on beat, like recording. And then you could choose whether you want it to be happy or slow or whatever.
Yeah.
And that's not even AI yet, but I'm thinking once they implement AI and you can be like, here's the footage. I want to cut to this song and I want it to be
energetic or I want it
energetic.
To have
sound. It's because what you see, it actually is a beginning stage of AI.
Yeah, for sure.
Because it starts out as a program that you're having specifically what it does. Then you move into an algorithm. And that's what pretty much is a premature AI.
Yeah. The algorithm for sure.
Yeah, you know? So that's the deep learning is also too is speech to text or speech to
talk
to AI.
Right.
Yeah, talk to text. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it's a form of that type of technology. But in the future, we will. I mean, we're right now trying to tinker with it. You know, there's a lot of TikTok videos like, you can train your Alexa or your Google Home to be your personal assistant with voice act. And so we went down a rabbit hole and we're like, fuck, we're going to try to program it. And we've been trying to get the developer license or go through and get an API directly like to Facebook and stuff. Cause you got to give it permission to access your emails. You got to give it permission to do all this. But at what point does it start to fucking act as you?
Regarding the algorithms and the AI and stuff, I was actually, I tweeted at Apple the other day about when they're going to
Step it up.
They're going to implement AI to Siri, because we already have Siri, and Siri's a dope assistant because it could do things for you. But when Siri becomes AI, and I'm pretty sure it will real soon.
I think that's the next update.
Yeah, I think like Siri is going to be able to do so many things for you, and not just like right now. I think it's programmed to even tell you a joke, or it's programmed to like look online and pull information from Google, for example. But I think once Siri becomes AI, it's going to be really, really, really powerful, especially dealing with a company like Apple that's just going to buy the best of the best. So I'm looking forward to see how that is going to work out.
Our workflows are going to be different. I don't think we're going anywhere like from a media standpoint. I think it's just going to change the way we're going to do things. You know, like you said, we're going to be doing more of the creative side of stuff more than the labor of. You know,
like I've been spending the past 4 days, I've just been on my laptop organizing files and then converting, like I guess converting codecs, because when I get files from the camera, they're big files. And then when I realize, okay, I have like 300 files that I'm not going to use, and they're taking up like a hard drive space. So what I've been doing lately is Mac has a really good codec function where you can go in and encode the video.
Yeah.
And it brings it down to 1/3 of the size. So what I've been doing, like if I have a file that's like 50 gigabytes, I encode it and it turns it into 10 gigabytes and it's still the same video. It's still HD. It just gets rid of, I don't know, half the weight somehow.
Like the metadata probably from that big file is probably
I'm sure the camera is adding so much information that it doesn't actually need.
Yeah.
So what I've been doing is I've just been going through all like the footage, and then it's just I've just been like encoding it, making it smaller and smaller. So if I could tell Siri, like, Siri, go through my hard drive and like downgrade all my video, and then I'm gonna free up like terabytes of space.
Think about that. The day that you can do that shit, it's like no longer the labor of sitting there moving files, you know, like exactly. Siri, go ahead and automate it, go ahead and organize my shit.
Yeah,
so the organization and the labor of organizing is gonna change, bro. It's gonna be there's things that I do worry about it, but there's also things from the business side, bro, that, you know, and people like us that have always like tinkered with shit, you know, we're going to be fine in so many ways, and we'll find ways to grow things and make things better, you know?
You know what AI is not going to be able to do is show up to a place for you, because I got to go. I got this thing at 5 p.m. I got this thing at 5 with Crystal, so we got to bounce.
All right, man. Shit. Well, I appreciate you coming through, D. Shit. For it was sure, a good yeah, it was a good conversation. We got to continue this conversation, because I know we're going to be dabbling in some stuff.
We'll continue at the new spot.
Part two
coming soon.
Yeah,
for sure. No, I had fun just sitting here with you guys. I mean, I don't know about the podcast aspect of it, but just to sit here and just chat with y'all like that, that's for fun. Sure. So whenever you're at the new spot, let me know. I want to go check it out.
We'll do it big, man. I'm happy that we did this show here at this place, because this is the last episode here. So the next time you guys see us, we'll be at the new spot. So
for sure. Yeah. Thanks for Easy. Having me, homies. Peace. Appreciate it. Peace. That's cut. Let me get up. Oh, I got a rule too.
I'm busy. Hey, seeing you, buddy. Good. Show the shit. Sheesh. Somebody's up in there. I thought I got this.